My name is Bert Freeman. I'm the sensei of the Toronto Academy of Karate, Fitness, and Health. Today we're going to do a lot of exciting demonstrations for you. The agenda basically is the kata demonstrations. We'll start around half an hour or 45 minutes from now, around 10 o'clock at the latest. And the sparring competition will be around 11 and a quarter to 11. Going up to 11:30, 11:12, and we hope to still do some more demos after the main competition. So try and stay for the whole time if you can. Our school has existed almost 50 years, and we have achieved an international reputation for high standards of intelligent, disciplined, and rigorous training of authentic, traditional karate goals. All our classes are taught by senior black belt instructors with over 25 years of training experience. We have a very unusual dojo this way because most dojos, instructors really don't have anywhere near the experience that we have. And the reason these black belts are still training is because they are actually actively training and enjoying and loving what they do. Otherwise, they wouldn't be here. The dojo works on a volunteer basis for the advanced black belts and even middle belts as they learn to teach others. Dojo is very much family focused, and we're focused on helping each other improve. The tournament today is not about competing against others to win. It's actually bringing yourself to the best you can be. We do have a self-defense component to it, but our training actually prepares us. All of our training that we do, both kata demonstrations and sparring, prepare us for self-defense. If we should need it. So this is our 46th annual tournament. We actually started in 1970, but we used to go to outside tournaments in the initial years, but we found the judging was very poor. There was a lot of contact, even though they said non-contact, and so we were sustaining a lot of injuries by going to other tournaments, even though we were winning all the trophies. So we decided we had enough students ourselves to start our own tournament where we can control the tournament and people don't get hurt, okay? We are strictly non-contact. When you get to be black belt, that means this close. When you're a white belt, you're like 2 feet away. Any contact to the head is immediate disqualification. Heavy contact to the body is a warning or disqualification, depending on what the judge decides. We have zero tolerance on people getting injured. We're not here to hurt each other, we're here to help each other. So you're going to see some amazing demonstrations of strength and true karate spirit this morning. Before we start the competition, I want to demonstrate some self-defense techniques. We've been talking this year a lot about bullying.
Hey you! Is that your mother dressed you in that gi, whatever that is? Hey, you think you're a really tough karate guy?
Yeah!
Oh, I broke my nose! Oh my god!
You're fine.
Oh, get away from me, creep.
Okay, now we'll do it slow. So I'll show you what happens. Your average bully tries to get you, well, try to get themselves pumped up a bit closer. So it will often start with a push. Okay? Which is what he tried to do with me. So this is an easy thing. It's very nice of them to give us this opportunity. Because as the push comes in, we do either an inside-outside block, double, or upper block, depending on where they are. If it's higher or upper, otherwise we're inside-outside. From here, oh nice, we have our hands right here in this case. Yeah! We can also do it by pick. But that's just one way of doing it. Another way a bully might attack is if they just want to go right into fighting.
Hey, what are you doing there? I think you're a tough guy, don't you?
Yeah!
What we try to do here is break the arm, okay, and
yeah!
Arms up to an elbow.
I really hit him, he wouldn't be resisting it. Okay? So slowly, again, slowly. So the technique here is, notice I go back into a good Fibonacci stance, horse stance. This is to create a solid base for a strong block. This should really break the arm. Okay? With a powerful strength. Okay? Because I'm using all my body power. I'm using my hips, my thrust, my right shoulder. So that by itself should stop them. But just in case, we grab the arm, maybe we missed, maybe we didn't. And the elbow here is really finishing. Break the jaw, knock them out, whatever. Okay? And if they have a weapon, the thing is with a weapon is you have to be careful.
Give me your money.
So he's got a knife. Okay, there's two things. I could run, but he's probably going to chase me and stab me or slash me or something. He does not want to stab me, actually. Even if he had a gun, he doesn't want to shoot me. Because he goes to jail.
He just wants your money.
Yeah, he just wants money. So it's a threat. So the thing is, you got to distract him, remove the problem, and take care of him. So what we do in this case is, I'm standing here, I come back here. You want my money?
Yeah, your money. All right, dead so money.
There's my phone. While he's looking down, yeah! With regular ongoing training to achieve a calm mind so that you will react spontaneously. That's the whole key. Now, also, some of you may not know that an important component of our training is Zen philosophy. Zen philosophy helps us develop our character, our awareness, and our will. So it's not just physical training. If you go to a kickboxing club, yeah, but here, you're training your mind and your spirit and your heart, which is far more important than anything else. You can get a lot away with a lot of not terribly strong technique if you've got the spirit to deal with the situation. To achieve the inner strength awareness required, Zen philosophy is a critical part of our karate training. Now I would like to introduce one of our senior black belts, Mr. Ernest Cadorn. Ernest has recently published a book called The Arrows of Zen. And he's here to give you a little bit insight into Zen and its importance in our character development.
Thank you. Aikido is a Japanese martial art, and its foundations are in Zen Buddhism. So, as Sensei said, when we learn authentic karate-do, which is what we learn in this dojo, we learn not just the physical techniques, the punches, the blocks, the kicks, but also other aspects that relate to developing our mind and developing our character. And this is often done by way of stories that are passed down by word of mouth from generation to generation. And I want to tell you a very quick story this morning. It's a story that relates to something called mu no kokoro, which means mind of emptiness, or mind without conscious thought. And what we're talking about here is the idea of being able to do an activity, something that you're very proficient in. It could be a kata that you've been practicing for months or even years, it could be sparring, it could even be something as routine as vacuuming a room. But being able to do this activity with a clear mind, your mind is directing your actions, but you're not trapped in thought, you're not overthinking things, okay? You're working fluidly. It's almost like a moving meditation. So the story is about a woodsman who lives near the forest. And he was checking out his wood supply, and he noticed that he was running low. He would need plenty of wood to fuel his furnace and his fireplace and his stove for the winter months. So he packed himself a bit of lunch, brought his axe up onto his shoulder and wandered into the woods and went to a familiar clearing and started gathering the wood that he would need, chopping the larger pieces into smaller pieces, bundling them up into piles so that he could bring them back to his cabin. And he was pretty satisfied with how his work was going when suddenly he noticed that someone was watching him. And this someone or something was a gremlin. Okay? A gremlin is like a magical elf, but a real troublemaker, this guy. And what this gremlin started to do was interfere with the woodsman's work. Like, he would get in his way as the woodman was trying to chop. He would knock down piles that the woodsman had made. He would even eat the woodsman's lunch. Okay? So this was important work that the woodsman was trying to do. And in a matter of a few minutes, the gremlin ruined the whole morning of work. So the woodsman decided to take some action. He got a firm grip on his axe, and he charged at the gremlin, and he swung the axe at the gremlin. But the gremlin was too fast and magical, too, so he just disappeared a split second before the axe hit him, and then he reappeared behind him. So he turned and swung at him again, and again, just a split second before it hit him, disappeared. This time he reappeared up in a tree. The woodsman threw his axe, he was just about to hit him, disappeared again, reappeared somewhere else. So this skirmish went on for quite some time. And no matter how hard the woodsman tried to hit the gremlin was always just a split second too fast. So after a while, his determination gave way to frustration, and he kind of gave up. So he thought to himself, well, I can't get any work done with this gremlin, and I can't get rid of this gremlin. I might as well just go home and try again tomorrow. Okay? So he picked up his axe, brought it up to his shoulder, but it accidentally slipped out of his hands, and bam! No mind. Any questions about the story? Okay. So as Sensei said, if you like the story, this one and several other ones are in the book that I've just written. If you'd like a copy of the book, come and see me sometime this morning, and I have a few copies up on the table. If you want to give it as a gift for someone, or even if it's just for yourself, I'd be happy to write an inscription in it. If you prefer ebook or audiobook format, it's also available formats at Amazon, Apple, and other online stores. Thank you. Chris Kadori, Matsukaze Sandai.
Shell, come on, come.
Chinto. Thank you.
Shimei!
Hey!
Hey!
Okay?
Yes, I am, sir.
Points on the side, 2 points, winner. Hey.